Well, good morning, everyone, and happy Thanksgiving to you all. It is great to be in the house of the Lord today, and I love that we get to gather in worship. I don't know what you've been like, but I've been struggling with my health a little bit this week, as you can hear it in my voice, is a little bit raw. And so I'm trying my best to push through, sucking on the halls, but I'm just excited to be able to proclaim the word of God to you this morning. If you're watching online, or maybe the first time in the room, first time in a long time back in the room, we are just so happy that you are with us. We are starting a brand new series entitled Our Identity in Christ, as we look at Paul's letter in Ephesus. And I'm thrilled about this. I'm excited to jump into the study together with you. We're going to talk about that more in just a minute. But before we do, I just want to kind of circle back to an announcement we made last week, where we are beginning to dream. We're dreaming big, really, for the future. And many of you know that we have this God-sized vision to make a difference in our community. We want to see Jesus-sized difference in our community. The one we like to describe it as, we call it the overflow effect. If we are growing an overflowing relationship with Jesus, then what's the overflow effect of that relationship? Whether that is personally for me, or whether that's, you know, for you, or whether that's corporately for us as a church, what difference is God calling us to make? And we just want to see Jesus-centered community transformation. And we've kind of honed that around three focuses: about protecting the vulnerable, helping those out of poverty, and planting life-giving churches. And in regards to that, as we examine what it means for us in our own community, about 6 months ago, half a dozen of us started asking this question. And here's the question: is there room for a new type of elementary school in Kincardine that would deliver world-class education, that values partnership with parents, and believes God's truth is a foundation for all wisdom and genuine learning? Amen. And it's a scary question. It's a big, audacious question. And honestly, we believe it does. We believe so. We believe that. We also know that this dream is just too big for anyone to do alone. And so we're taking a step of faith. We're giving voice to some of the whispers maybe you've been hearing, and we're opening up the conversation to do three things. We need to learn from educators. We need to identify interested parents, and then engage with potential donors, really in that order. And while we want to meet with parents, and while we want to connect with potential donors who are going to invest into the future and leave a legacy, we need to learn as a kind of our concrete next step from educators who have been maybe asking this type of question. You know, maybe they're a part of the current education system, or maybe been a part of it in the past, and they see kind of what we see, and they're asking the same kind of questions that we're asking. We want to learn from you, because we realize there's a lot of things we just don't know. And I don't know if we're brave enough, full of faith enough, or naive enough, whatever you want to call it, to ask the question. And to walk in faith and obedience. Last week, we talked about one of the values of following Jesus, just sort of doing it scared. And this is kind of what we're doing. We're kind of doing it scared. But so if that's you, if you're an educator, a parent, or a donor, we have a website and a page on our website called theharbourchurch.com/school. Kind of outlines what we were talking about there, but also just allows you to fill out an interest form so we can get some of your information and then reach out to you and kind of pull you into a conversation at the right time. So if that's you, or maybe you know somebody, you want to spread the news. This is not a Harbour thing. You know, we're trying to start it, but we're really trying to do something for our community. And so feel free to spread that, and let's just see where God leads us as we faithfully follow after him. If that's not you, we invite you to pray with us, pray for us as we take these steps, that God will give us wisdom as we protect the vulnerable and dream big for the future. Amen. Can we do that together? Amen. Some of you are excited. In 2005, Ridley Scott directed probably one of my most favorite movies of all time. It was called The Kingdom of Heaven. And it starred Orlando Bloom. And it was this beautiful movie. If you love war, epic battle scenes, this is the one you love. And really, it's a tale of a young Frenchman who discovered his destiny as a knight during the Crusades. It's this world-shaping collision between Europe and the East. And the scene that I want to kind of explain to you, if you'll indulge me here this morning, happens kind of near the end, you know, near the end of the movie, before the final battle scene, as you will, so the big climax to this moment. And this new arrogant king of England foolishly leads his army into the desert to face the vast army from the east, leaving Jerusalem completely defenseless. Meanwhile, this young, newly minted knight, Orlando Bloom, you know, stays behind because of this kingdom of conscience, doesn't believe what they're trying to do. So he stays behind. And the army of England fell, and now the Eastern army is approaching Jerusalem, and there's fear and panic, as you can imagine, among the people in Jerusalem. And the bishop, this character plays the bishop in this moment, he goes up to this young, newly minted knight, and he says with fear, and he implores him to abandon Jerusalem and just flee, leaving the people completely defenseless. And he says to this knight, he says, "How can we defend Jerusalem without knights? We have no knights." And this young Orlando Bloom character looks around, and he sees the men and women around him. He says, "Truly." He looks around, he takes notice, and he sees the faces of young and old men. He sees servants and gravediggers and masons and farmers and merchants and weathered, tired men. And then he says something. He says, "Any man at arms or capable of bearing them, kneel." And in this moment, as they all kneel, a whole, you know, you can just imagine with me this, all these guys just fall to their knees, they take a knee. And then he reads them the oath of a knight. He says, "Will you be without fear in the face of your enemies? Be brave and upright that God may love thee. Speak truth always, even if it leads to your death. And safeguard the helpless and do no wrong. This is your oath." And then he takes his glove and he slaps one of the young kids. He says, "That's so you don't forget it, you know." And then he says something so profound. He says, "Rise, a knight." And the same group of men who looked beat up, who looked discouraged, who looked like they were victims, all of a sudden gathered a new sense of fervency and urgency and empowerment. And as they stood up with a little bit more confidence in their being. And this bishop, who still has no idea what's really going on, he doesn't get it. He turns to this young knight. He says, "Who do you think you are? Do you plan to alter the world? Does making a man a knight make him a better fighter?" And the music, if you can listen, just builds up this big, beautiful moment. And Orlando Bloom, he's not even facing him. He's looking around. And then the music stops, and he turns around, and he says, "Yes." End scene. That's the scene. And I don't know about you, but that movie gets me. I love that movie. I love that scene. I think it speaks to something every one of us desire and long for, which is identity. We want to know who we are. And here's kind of the crux of our series, or kind of the big idea of really the whole series that we're going to be talking about is this, is that when how we see ourselves impacts how we live. Like how we see ourselves impacts how we live. Our identity, identity are really the qualities and the beliefs that make up a person, the totality of who we are. So how we see ourselves impacts how we actually live. Our past experiences, whether they're good or they're bad, our family, our childhood, our social upbringing, our education and opportunities, our friendships and our influences, all of these things in part shape who we are and how we see ourselves, don't they? How we see ourselves. And so here's the question I want to ask you to think about and ponder on as we begin to lay the foundation for this series this morning, is how do you see yourself? How would you describe who you are? How do you define yourself? This is not a new question. This is a question that humanity has really been asking since the beginning of time as we've been searching for our meaning in our life. It's a question that has been asked at the beginning of time. At one point, we saw ourselves in relation to others, the community and the family that we were a part of. But today, that question seems to be screaming louder. And rather than creating a greater sense of confidence and clarity, from my perspective, it seems that it's creating more confusion and destroying our families and our communities as we become more and more individualistic. See, we focus on what makes us unique or different rather than what unites us around a common purpose. We focus on what we lack where we fall short and where we've allowed others to say who we are. And here is kind of what I want us to understand. Without getting into all the nuances and the details, here's what I want you to know, is that no matter how you see yourself or no matter how you and I describe ourselves, once we make a commitment to follow Jesus, everything changes. There's this adage that we say, and we say it here, it's on the wall outside, is that Jesus changes everything. What does this mean? It means that no matter who we came to Jesus as, once we found Jesus, we are now a new creation. It doesn't matter how we identified ourselves before Jesus. In Jesus, everything changes. Our life completely turns upside down. Our full identity is in Him alone. As you study and when you and I make a decision to, as we talked about already, deny ourselves, take up our cross daily and follow Him, what happens is that we get a new identity in Christ. Our past is redeemed. Our present makes sense and our future is secure. Paul, the Apostle Paul, who wrote most of the New Testament, he's talking to the church in Philippi and he's kind of boasting a little bit about who he was and his credentials of how he lived. He says in Philippians 3, verse 4, he says, "If someone else thinks they have reason to put confidence in the flesh, I have more." What's he saying? Listen, if somebody else thinks they're better than me, let me tell you, you're not. You know, when it comes to earthly flesh, when it comes to the flesh, when it comes to the earthly commitments and earthly standards, I've crushed it, he says. I've crushed this thing. You can't compare yourself to me. And he goes on, he kind of explains it. He says, "I've been circumcised on the eighth day." It's a common Jewish practice. "Of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin." The Benjamin is the tribe. That's where David came from and Jesus came from. I'm the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews. "In regards to the law, I was a Pharisee." It means I lived and I preached it. I upheld the law. "As for zeal, I was persecuting the church. As for righteousness based on the law, I was faultless. I did everything right." But then he says, "But whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ." You see, what Paul is identifying here, he's saying, listen, it doesn't matter who I was before Christ. It doesn't matter all the successes I had and all the failures I might have had and the life I would have lived. He is making a leadership statement to the church in Philippi that amongst all of his greatest achievements of his life, he makes a statement that he considers it all rubbish. It doesn't matter. It doesn't even compare to coming come close to the life that he has now in Christ. When he met Jesus on the road to Damascus to persecute the church, his life, his credentials, his purpose, his identity was changed forever. And from that moment on, Paul's full identity was in Christ alone. And so over the next few weeks, we're going to explore what our identity in Christ is. And we're going to kind of hang out in Paul's letter to the church in Ephesus, in Ephesians. And today, what I really just hope to do today is just kind of lay a foundation that kind of puts us all on the same page. Colin Urquhart's book, In Christ Jesus, he kind of focuses on the significance of this little word, in. This word, in, as we see it in the New Testament. See, understanding that as Christians, you are in Christ, what that does is it revolutionizes how you see yourself. It revolutionizes your self-image, your identity, and how you understand your value to God. He kind of talks about this illustration. He says, you got to just take a piece of paper and write your name on a piece of paper. That's my name. I can't really read it sometimes, but that's my name. And he says, you take your piece of paper and you put it in the Bible where it represents Christ, and you put it in and you close it. He says, in that moment, you are in Christ. Wherever the book goes, you go. And wherever you go, the book goes. You are enveloped in Christ. You are not a part. You are not a part of the book, but you are connected to the book. You identify with Him. You are enveloped in Christ. When God looks at you, He sees His Son, and you are clothed in righteousness. You are consumed and covered in Christ. Paul uses this imagery, this illustration, that when we are in Christ Jesus over and over, as he told, as he places you in Christ, and he talks about the spiritual blessings, Ephesians 1:3. He says, Paul says, "Praise be to the God of the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ." Like, when we are in Christ, we are enveloped with all the spiritual blessings of what it means to be part of Christ's family and Christ's body. Just in Ephesians alone, he highlights being chosen and predestined. He highlights being adopted as children of God. He highlights being redeemed and forgiven. He highlights being sealed with the Holy Spirit, being raised and seated in heavenly places, created for good works, reconciled to God and to one another, gain access to the Father, and members of the body of Christ. These are things that we have in Christ and not of ourselves. These passages emphasize the believer's new identity, spiritual blessings, and profound relationship we have with God in Christ. And so this morning, real quick, as we gauge the first kind of part of his letter, I want to highlight three things that we have in Christ to put us on the same page. You with me this morning? The first thing we need to know is that when we are in Christ, our past is redeemed. Our past is redeemed. Ephesians 1:7. It says, in him, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace. See, when we come to Christ, our past is no longer a burden. I think it's beautiful that Paul is saying this, because I think Paul is sharing from his personal experience. When Paul came to Christ, he recognizes the error of his ways, and he recognized how much of a sinner he truly was. Actually, in 2 Timothy, or 1 Timothy rather, he says, "I am the chief of sinners." And he's recognizing that in Christ, we are not who we used to be. Our past no longer defines us. We are made new. We are redeemed. We are set apart. We have been given a clean slate because of what Christ has done. Our sins and mistakes, no matter how grave, are forgiven through the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross. And this is something that we in our own minds have a hard time fully grasping, because in our minds we kind of compartmentalize, what's that word? You know what I mean? That's the one. You know, our sins, we say this one's a worse sin and this one's not a good sin, but we just say, no, we're all sinners. Every one of us have fallen short of the glory of God. And God's grace is abundant and covers all of our transgressions. It doesn't matter who we are or what you've done. When you come to the cross, you are forgiven. Romans 6:23 says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God, or the grace of God, is eternal life." And in Christ Jesus, our Lord. It just, you got to come. Your past is forgiven. I'm often reminded of the thief on the cross who, in his last dying breaths, turned to Jesus and said, "Remember me." And Jesus responds, "Today you will be with me in paradise." His past was redeemed in a moment. In a moment. And there's nothing that he did to deserve that. He wasn't baptized. He didn't go through discipleship classes. He didn't tithe. He just said, "Remember me, Lord." And when we come to Christ, our past is forgiven. There's this illustration, and many of us heard, as you imagine, this is a courtroom scene where we stand guilty from our past sins. We stand in front of the judge, and we are guilty. We have made a mistake. It's like being pulled over by a cop for speeding and knowing you can't even argue because you were, you know? Sometimes you try to argue it, but then there's other times you're like, "I was speeding. Like, I did it. Like, I'm guilty," you know? And then you present yourself at the mercy of the officer. And we do that, I mean, when it comes to sin, when we recognize that we are in need of Savior, when we recognize our sin, we recognize that the wages of sin is death. We recognize that what we have done has separated us from God. And we stand in front of the judge and he condemns us to death because that is our sin and that is our deserve. That's what we deserve. But then our prosecutor, our defense attorney comes in and he assumes the penalty of our sin. He assumes the penalty. He pays the price because a just God and a just judge has got to issue the sentence. Somebody has got to pay. But our defense attorney, Jesus Christ, shows up. He says, "I'll take it. I'll pay it." And then God says to us, "You can go free. Your sins are forgiven." See, our past redeemed, our past is redeemed and reconciled through Christ's blood, granting us this new beginning, this clean slate. Come on, I'm talking about a clean slate. I'm not talking about like going into high school and you seeing a chalkboard that was sort of clean, you know, and it's got the streak marks on that. No. And, you know, it's like you can tell they tried. It was like a four-year-old tried to clean the chalkboard, you know, like that kind of clean. No. We're talking, it's like brand new. It's clean. It's brand new. Like there's a clean slate in Christ. Our past is redeemed. I'm not who I used to be. I'm forgiven. I'm set free. I'm made new in Christ. One of my favorite scriptures, I've said this many times, even the last month, is 2 Corinthians 5:21. That God made him, Christ, who had no sin, to be sin for who? Us, me, you. So that in him, in Christ, we might become what? The righteousness of God, meaning that in Christ, when Christ sees you, all he sees is his son. When God looks at you, he doesn't see the piece of, he sees his son. You are enveloped, you are in him. His righteousness is what God sees. His promise is for you. And don't allow the enemy to deceive you and to pull you away from receiving that. Because here's the truth, the enemy's gonna tell you, you don't deserve it. And guess what? He's right. Like, that's not a surprise. None of us deserve it. All of sin and falling short of the glory of God. But grace is getting what we don't deserve. And mercy is not getting what we do deserve. So in Christ, our past is redeemed and by God's great mercy and grace. And so when we understand our identity, if we want to understand who we are truly, we have to understand first that our past is redeemed. And in Christ, my past is redeemed, that who I was no longer determines who I'm going to be. Because of Christ, he's going to set me free. The second thing we understand is that in Christ, my present makes sense. My present makes sense. I love how Ephesians tells us, Paul says in Ephesians 2:10, he says, for we are God's workmanship created, what? In Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. This is something we say around here a lot, is that you were created on purpose, with purpose, for purpose. Maybe your identity has been shaped by the phrase unwanted or accident. And can I tell you that there are no accidents in God's creation? You may have been unplanned by your parents, but you were not an accident. And if you live in that mindset or that identity that I'm not wanted, that I'm not loved, that I've not been accepted by my own family, the ones who brought me, then you will always be searching for acceptance. But I'm here to tell you that God created you. What does Psalms 139 tells us? For you created my inmost being. This is David's cry. You knit me together in my mother's womb. And I praise you because I am, say it with me, fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. Listen, you were knit together, created on purpose with a purpose. And in Christ, we get to discover our purpose and our calling. I love how Mark Twain says it. He says the two most important days of your life are the day that you were born and the day that you find out why. And that's our pursuit as a church. It's really one of the reasons why we do Growth Track, really, is to help you discover why you were born. See, God has uniquely designed each of us, and through faith in Christ, we come to realize the good works that he has prepared for us to do. So our life gains meaning and direction as we align ourselves with God's purpose. We follow him and engage in his plans. Consider the skilled artist creating a masterpiece. And in Christ, we are God's masterpiece, his artwork, his handcrafted artwork. And with each stroke, that brushes represents the moments of our lives. And our present makes sense when we allow God, the artist, to guide our actions and our choices, creating a beautiful and purposeful composition. Romans 8:28 says that we know that in all things, God works together for good for those who love him, for those who've been called according to his purpose. And you and I both know that all things aren't good, but we've also come to learn that God is good in all things. And how do you see God's goodness in our present? Is that we have to give him permission to redeem our past. If you want God to use your present and make your present make sense, you have to allow him to redeem your past and to use your story for his glory. So in Christ, my past is redeemed, my present makes sense, and in Christ, my future is secure. Ephesians 1, 13 and 14, in him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, you were sealed. You were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of his glory. See, through faith in Christ, you are sealed with the Holy Spirit, indicating God's ownership and his protection. You are his. This sealing guarantees an eternal inheritance and secures our future with him. In him, it's an assurance that nothing can separate us from God's love, and we can face the future with confidence and with hope. I love how Paul testifies to Timothy. He says, if we are unfaithful, he still remains faithful, for he cannot deny who he is. See, even a quick look at Israel's history, you can see how unfaithful they were to God. You just got to read the Old Testament. You see this reoccurring phrase over and over again, and it's like this. It goes something like this. Again, they did evil in the eyes of the Lord. Again, they were unfaithful. See, Israel, like many of us today, went through an identity crisis. They were constantly influenced by the other cultures and by the other powers of the known world, and they lost sight of who they were in Christ. They lost sight of who they were and who they actually belonged to. Yet even in the hardships they were brought upon themselves through their unfaithfulness, God was faithful. If you study the Old Testament, you realize that in the years following the rise of the Babylonian Empire, that when Jerusalem was in ruins and the temple was destroyed and the people were scattered, God spoke to the people of Israel through the prophet Jeremiah, and he said this. He says, listen, I know the plans I have for you. I know it looks like you're wandering. I know it looks like you're confused. I know it looks like it's not all coming together. I know it looks like your identity is lost. But I know the plans I have for you. I have plans to prosper you, not to harm you, to give you hope and a future. Remember that your identity is in me. You are mine. And I will not forsake my own. So I think it's really important for us, just as we lay this foundation of our conversation today, so that it doesn't matter who you are or what you've done or where you've been or what kind of identity crisis you are in, when you understand that we are in Christ, our past is redeemed, our future, our present makes sense, and our future is secure, that even in the chaos of life that we find ourselves in, when everything is crumbling around us, we can stand in the hope that everything is going to be okay. Because I'm not standing in my own identity. I'm not standing in my own strength. I'm not standing in my own power or abilities. But I'm standing in Christ. I'm enveloped in him. And when he says it's going to be okay, everything's going to be okay. My hope is in him. It's not in me. Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians, he says, for all the promises of God find their yes in him. Again, not in me, not in you. They're in him. That is why it is through him that we utter our amen to God for his glory. It is God who establishes us with you in Christ. He has anointed us and who has put a seal upon us and given us his spirit in our heart as a guarantee. Picture with me, if you will, a vault with a priceless treasure inside, symbolizing the security we future we have in Christ. And this vault is sealed and it's guarded and representing the Holy Spirit's protection and insurance of our inheritance. No matter what challenges we face in life, the treasure remains safe for us to claim when the time comes. See, for us to understand who we truly are, we need to understand whose we truly are. In Christ, our past is redeemed. Our present makes sense, and our future is secure. So how you see yourself is how you live. And on the heels of the conversation we had last month, if we want to be faithful, fruitful, all in followers of Jesus, then our identity needs to be rooted in Jesus. Our identity needs to be rooted and established in Christ. And by understanding and living the truth that in Christ our past is redeemed, our present makes sense, and our future secure, we can embrace a life of purpose and meaning and eternal hope. He goes on to tell us in Ephesians 4, he says, to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitudes of your mind, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. And that's what we're going to pick up next week. But how you see yourself this morning? Do you see yourself as lost? Do you see yourself as lonely? Do you see yourself as abandoned? Do you see yourself as unwanted? Do you see yourself as successful? Like Paul identified, I'm successful. In all earthly ways, I have everything I need to have. Or do you see yourself today rooted and established in Christ? Because how we see ourselves determine how we live. Let's pray. Father, this morning we just want to take a moment and say thank you for your word that is alive and active. Father, we thank you that your word reveals who we are in relationship to who you are. Father, this morning we take a moment and recognize your great love for us. And we thank you, Lord, that you loved us as we are, but you love us too much to leave us the way we are. And you bring us back into relationship with you. God, we thank you that you provided a hope and a future for us that is set apart, that is good and is pleasing, that will bring meaning and joy and hope. And today, by your Spirit of God, I pray that all accusations and criticisms and demeaning ideas and false labels that have stood against your people be broken over our lives in Jesus' name. That we would not get lost in the lies, that we would be established in the truth of your word. God, that in Christ we'd be accept and embrace our new identity as children of God. Spirit of God, would you renew our minds? Would you fill our hearts? Would you direct our steps as we follow after you? God, I pray for each one of my friends here this morning. Lord, that each one of us would leave this place with a sense of confidence today that we are yours, that we are in you, and that you direct our steps. If you're here this morning and you have never made your commitment to follow Jesus, one thing we find a joy to do is just to let you know that you can make that decision today. If you want to be a follower of Jesus, maybe throughout the whole service, you've just been sensing the Spirit of God. Maybe that's even why you were brought here this morning. You're just like, I just need Jesus. I've been searching for something and I just realized I need Jesus in my life. I recognize that I'm a sinner. I recognize that I'm far away from God and recognize the decisions I've made in the life that I'm living is not for him, but it's for me. And I want to surrender my life to him. If that's you across this place, I want to give you the opportunity even right now to receive forgiveness, to receive hope. Even like that thief on the cross that says, Lord, remember me. Remember me. You can make that prayer this morning. So I'm going to say a quick prayer. And again, it's not about the prayer, but it's about the heart's posture and your commitment in your heart to follow him, to say yes to him. And if I pray this prayer, just repeat it after me in your own words. Dear Jesus, thank you for loving me as I am, but loving me too much to leave me the way I am. Father, I recognize in this moment that I am a sinner, that I've made decisions that have broken your heart and lived for myself. Father, I acknowledge you as the Lord of my life. I recognize that you died on the cross, you were raised again, and because of your sacrifice, I can be forgiven and healed and be made new. And as much as I know now, God, I acknowledge you as Lord of my life. Please come into my heart. Direct my steps. I choose to follow you today. I know, I believe, help me trust. In your precious name we pray. Amen. Amen. If you prayed a prayer like that, maybe for the first time or the first time in a long time, We love to celebrate with you and just resource you with what you need to follow in him. This is a lifelong journey. And all you need to do is just take the Connect card that's found in the seat in front of you. Take a quick moment, fill that out, and bring them back to the Welcome Center. And we would love to just make sure we give you the resources you need to grow into that relationship with Jesus. I'm going to invite you to stand across your feet. Stand on your feet across this place. And stand across your feet. You know, that's... Work with me, your friends. I just want you to know how cherished you are, how loved you are, how precious you are. Don't let the enemy rob you of the future you have in Christ, but understand that your past is redeemed, your present makes sense, and your future secure in Christ alone. May we continue to live with that sense of confidence, not in us, but in him. And in boast in his strength and power, made complete in our weakness for his glory. So may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. I bless you now in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. If you are here and you need prayer, we have a ministry team here that would love to pray with you. Please take advantage of that opportunity before you leave. Happy Thanksgiving, everyone. You're dismissed. God bless.
We have faith going out here. There's nothing that our God can't do. In just one word, you calm the storm that surrounds me. Yeah, just one word, the darkness has to retreat. And just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. Yeah, just one touch, my eyes were open to see, my heart can't help but believe. Say, there's nothing that I got that. There's not a mountain that he can't move. Oh, praise the day that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. Oh, yeah, just one word, you hear what's broken inside. Just takes a word, oh, just one word.